Hi, welcome to the Signal Path. In this episode, we're going to talk about energy harvesting. There's an entire category of circuits and ICs called energy harvesting ICs, and their purpose is to extract power and energy from sources that either have very little power to offer or they can give you very little power at a time. And they always have to have the same property. These energy harvesting ICs are able to operate from tiny voltages and tiny currents, and they have to, because most of the times these spurious sources of energy don't have a lot of voltage to offer you. It could be, for example, a thermoelectric generator, which can only give you a couple of hundred millivolts, or maybe a tiny solar panel that can only give you 10 milliamps or so. So you can never connect a thermoelectric generator directly to your microcontroller, because the voltage is incompatible, the power is incompatible, and you're not going to be able to power your circuit directly. But if you have an energy harvesting circuit, you can slowly collect energy from your thermoelectric generator, store it in a battery or a supercapacitor, and then deliver it to your circuit in one big burst. So distributed sensors, for example, can use this, because the distributed sensor can be a standalone unit that's connected to nothing else and just slowly gathers energy from the environment, powers on momentarily, transmits some information, and then goes back to sleep. So these energy harvesting ICs have to be very efficient. But you have to remember, we are not breaking laws of thermodynamics here. That's impossible. You don't get to say something is impossible very often. But breaking thermodynamics laws is pretty impossible. So at the end of the day, even if your IC is 100% efficient, you can only put as much energy in your circuit that you gather. So it may take you a very long time to collect enough energy to operate your circuit. So I have gotten a hold of a bunch of ICs that do this type of application, and they're very sophisticated because they do a lot of different things at the same time, telling you whether you've reached the power that you want, making sure the current is limited, making sure you don't completely drain your energy source. So we'll talk about all of that and the block diagram and how these type of circuits work and possibly how they can work from such tiny voltages. So let's look at the kind of circuits we have, build a bunch of experiments, and see what happens. Linear technology offers a whole array of energy harvesting ICs, and this is their portfolio that you can download from their website at www.linear.com. They also, of course, have a whole bunch of other different types of ICs for all kind of applications, and they make some very nice products. So what I wanted to discuss about the energy harvesting is, let's look at their portfolio and see what kind of ICs they offer, and let's pick two of them that I thought were interesting, and then we can do experiments with them. But at the same time, we can see what kind of stuff you can do with these energy harvesting ICs. So for example, they have an energy source category up here that allows you to kind of narrow your choices. If you have a piezoelectric generator, for example, what these two ICs are specifically intended for use with piezoelectric transducers. Now, piezoelectric transducers offer you a voltage when you apply mechanical energy to them, so they convert mechanical energy to electrical energy, but they have to generate a lot of voltage. They generate a large voltage in the presence of mechanical force, but at very low current. So the minimum input voltage for these two ICs, you know, this one is 14 volts to 20 volts, and the other one is 2.7 volts to 20 volts, and they both use a buck converter. So, you know, they're very interesting, but I'm not too interested in piezoelectric transducers. But if you are trying to harvest mechanical energy directly from something that's vibrating all the time, this would be the kind of IC you have to be looking at. And if you go down the list, we have thermoelectric type of energy source. Now, thermoelectric sources can give you, they give you very little voltage in the presence of differences in voltages, and they have three models that is directly intended for use for thermoelectric energy sources: the LTC3108, the LTC3108-1, and the LTC3109. And each of them have a different type of features that come with that IC. For example, the LTC3108-1 gives you fixed output voltages, 2.5, 3 volts, 3.7, or 4.5 volts, or so on. The one that I really like, that I thought was interesting, is this one, the LTC3109, that gives you auto-polarity, meaning that you could have the polarity of your thermoelectric generator either positive or negative, and it doesn't matter, it doesn't care. This is very interesting and opens up a bunch of applications where your temperature difference between the two points where your thermoelectric is placed can vary greatly, can actually be positive or negative, and your IC will still operate. So this is one of the ones that we're going to try out. And this particular one can operate as low as 20 millivolts. So you can give it 20 millivolts and it can give you a fixed output voltage up to 5 volts that you can use. which is really quite amazing when you think about it. And we'll talk about how they're able to do something like that. If you go further down the list, they have another IC that I think is very interesting, the LTC3105, which is a 400 milliamp step-up DC-DC converter with maximum power control and so on. But it can start up for as low as 250 millivolt. Now, why wouldn't I use the thermoelectric one if I want really low startup voltage? It's because this guy cannot give me a lot of power. So I wanted to experiment with two different ICs, one for very low voltage, very low power applications, the other one for very low voltage still, but moderately more power consumption. Now this 400 milliamp startup DC-DC step-up converter that they're talking about, this 400 milliamp is actually not the power it can deliver, but it's the power that it can absorb. So you have to be a little bit careful about that. They can really give you only about 110 millivolt milliamp at about 5 volts, which is pretty good. And it can work anywhere from 0.2 volts all the way up to 5 volts. And your voltage that you give the DC-DC converter here can be below or above the voltage that it's generating for you, which is another nice feature for this one. So I am going to take the LTC3105 and the LTC3109, and I'm going to do some experiments with them. So let's start with the LTC3105 and look at its evaluation board and see what we can do with it. So here's the block diagram of the LTC3105. This is what's actually happening inside the chip, and it shows what components are necessary outside the IC for it to work. And you can see it requires very few external components, and we'll talk about a little bit of that later as well. So at the input of the IC, you can give it anywhere from 225 millivolt all the way up to 5 volts. It cannot start with 225 millivolt. It needs at least 0.25 volts, so about 25 millivolt higher than this in order to start up. Once it starts up, then the voltage can drop to 225 millivolt and the whole IC continues to operate. At the output, you can select your output voltage anywhere from 1.5 volts to 5.25 volts, depending on the ratio of the resistor R1 and R2, which is then fed back into the circuit in order to have a loop and adjust the output voltage. Simultaneously, it also has a built-in LDO, linear regulator, which is going to be much more quiet than the output voltage itself because it is regulated rather than unregulated. So because of that, because the LDO uses the output voltage itself in order to produce an output, LDO can never exceed Vout. So for example, if you have set your output voltage to 5 volts, you can set your LDO to 3.3 volts. And this is very useful because you can use your LDO to power a sensor or power a microcontroller, and you can use the Vout for everything else. It has also some other interesting features. Of course, it has shutdown. By enabling the shutdown pin of the circuit itself, then it goes into a very quiet mode and consumes no power at all, and allows, for example, the energy source that you're using to recover, or maybe if you want to turn off everything else, you can use the shutdown pin. It also has something else that's very useful called the maximum power point control functionality. And what that does is that it makes sure that you never take enough energy from your energy source such that it falls below a certain voltage. Now, why would that be useful? Well, some things like, for example, solar panels don't work very well if the output voltage has collapsed to near zero. So you can tell this IC, hey, don't let my solar panel output voltage to drop below 1 volt. If you think that's going to happen, just take less energy from it and give me less energy at the output, but make sure that I use my energy source where it's most efficient. Sometimes energy sources are most efficient when their output voltage is at least a certain value, and you can find out the efficiency of your voltage source by looking at its IV characteristic and finding the largest product of the two. So in terms of external components, obviously because this is a boost converter, it's going to require some external inductor. So in this case, it only requires one, and that is between pin 6 and 7. And the switch that is used for the boost conversion process, of course, internally built into the IC itself. The IC has a low voltage startup circuitry, which is some proprietary linear technology circuit, which they don't show you, but you can kind of guess what it might be. They probably operate their MOSFET devices or their transistors in a sub-threshold region so that they're very sensitive to small voltages. And once you give it just a little bit of voltage, it kicks in, takes some current from the inductor, brings the voltage at the output high enough, and then once the voltage reaches a certain value, then the rest of the circuit can crank forward and start working. And that's probably what they do, because they tell you that during startup, the auxiliary voltage will reach 1.4 volts, and when it reaches 1.4 volts, then the circuit enters normal operation. And once this guy has reached the 1.4 volts, then this transistor here allows the charge to come back from the auxiliary voltage and go to the output. So in order for your output to reach the voltage that you want. And this auxiliary voltage is what is also used, if you look here, the auxiliary voltage is what's used for the linear regulator portion, this Vaux and this auxiliary voltage are connected. And also, if you look at the way the MPPC, the maximum power point control functionality works, as they have an internal 10 microamp current source, and that 10 microamp current source is pushed into this node, and it travels and goes outside the circuit. So by putting a resistor in here, the IV, the current times the resistor would create a voltage in here, and that voltage goes into a transconductor comparator here, a transconductor generator here, where the input voltage is taken from here. So by putting a voltage in here and comparing it to the input voltage, the transconductance GM unit here creates a current, which is then pushed into these two op amps here internally, and that controls the peak current control and the valley current control inside the circuit, making sure that the input source that you're using to give the circuit energy doesn't fall below a certain value. All of that is, of course, taken care of automatically. There's another good useful function, and that is the PGood, the power good pin. The power good pin can be used. It's an open drain output, so you're gonna have to put your own resistor in there, which can be very large, of course. And the benefit of that is that once everything settles down and the output voltage and the LDOs and have actually settled, and that the output voltage is what you want it to be, this PGood will actually be activated, and you know that, hey, I've reached a stable operation. I am actually getting what I'm asking the LDO to LDO and the output voltage to provide me with. So by using this power good pin, the MPCC and the shutdown, you can take all of those guys and actually bring them out to something and control them manually to play around with the chip and see what you can do with it. So let's look at the evaluation board. So here's the LTC3105 evaluation board that I have. I have two of these, which we're going to use for an experiment. And if you look at this board, they have taken all the important pins which you might be interested in all around this nice large evaluation board, which makes it quite easy to use because the actual circuit is very small. If you look at the center, the LTC3105 is placed right there in the middle. Let me see if I can get this thing to focus. There we go. And you can see the inductor on the left. Find something to point with. Here we go. So here's our little inductor, which is 10 microhenry, the IC itself, and the resistors that I've shown that are required to set the feedback voltage, and there's a couple of decoupling capacitors which sits on the auxiliary voltage, and so on. So the actual circuit is really small, and if I were to measure how much area you would need for the circuit itself, on one side, let's say you have about this much, that's 10 millimeters. And on the other side, you have probably about the same amount, maybe a little bit less. So you need only about maybe a 10 by 8, 10 by 9 millimeter of area to completely implement, including inductor, this component, which is very, very small. So it's very good for portable, tiny distributed sensors or other kind of applications. So besides the input, the output of the LDO is taken out right at the bottom. So you can see the LDO is selectable between 1.5, 2.2, and 3 volts at 6 milliamps. And the actual boost output can be 1.8, 3.3, and 5. And the reason these are discrete values is because they have set jumpers, jumper 1 and jumper 2, in order to set the LDO voltage as well as the boost voltage. But really, if you put a potentiometer or if you choose your own resistor value, these can be anything, which makes this a very versatile IC. At the same time, they have given us a shutdown jumper, so you can move the jumper between an on and off position. Right now, it's in the off position. And they also give you can apply it externally. The maximum power point control pin is also taken out, but they also give you IC. They also give you a jumper here to control the IC. You can set it to 4 volts, 2 volts, 0.4 volts, or to a diode. Now, the reason you have a diode in here is that if you have something that is changing with temperature, if you put the maximum power point control on the diode and apply your own diode across these two terminals, you can have something that tracks temperature behavior in order to stay optimum for power transfer. So that's another little feature that's in there that you can use. Other than that, everything else is available. There's the power good pin as well, so you can connect that to a resistor, and it allows you to choose whether you want to have the end of that resistor internally biased or externally biased yourself. You can apply your own voltage on the other side. So the board is very nice, very well made. The soldering is very good, and it really demonstrates how small the circuit can be. At the same time, this board is quite nice and large that can be used for all kind of experiments. So I know you've been waiting for to see it working, but let me show you one other thing first. The board also comes with its own full schematic, so you can see how simple the schematic is. And again, the IC is in the middle. Here's our inductor that goes around the circuit. These are all the jumpers that control the maximum power point control. The VP good output voltage, again, very simple. Here's our shutdown. Here's the resistors they use in order to create the output voltage. So you can see if you put your own, you can actually add your own potentiometer right here on this jumper and control the output voltage. Here's the LDO voltage. So very, very simple. This is all the circuit you need to get started and use this circuit. So if you even buy the bare die, or sorry, the bare IC, you can put it on a PCB very easily. So let's turn it on and see what happens. So here I have the evaluation board connected up to the power supply. So in order to provide it with a controlled voltage source, I'm using the Qthley 2400, which is a source meter. So it allows me to set the voltage and see precisely the current consumption of the circuit at various loads. At the same time, I've connected the Fluke 289 to the main output voltage and the Fluke 196 to the regulated output voltage. Right now the board is set to configured for, if you look at the jumpers, I've configured it such that it will provide 5 volts using this jumper and provide 3 volts from the LDO and the other jumper. It's turned on, so it's not in sleep mode, and by connecting the maximum power point control pin to ground, I've disabled the MPPC altogether, which means that the unit is allowed to take as much power and as much current from the source as possible. So if I do that, I can go ahead and try and see what happens if I turn the source meter on and slowly raise the voltage. So the source meter is configured right now to provide a maximum of 1 amp, but right now it's at 0 volts, so I turn it on. Obviously nothing happens, it's drawing no current, that's just essentially noise, and you can see the voltages on both the LDO and the output voltage is 0. So when the unit starts to work, we should expect to see 5 volts here and 3 volts here. This is under no load, meaning that the output, the main output and the LDO output of the evaluation board are connected to no load at all. The only load the circuit sees are the little resistors that are on the board itself, which are very large, in the order of hundreds of kilo ohms, and the load input impedance of the multimeters, again, which is very high, 10 mega ohms. So let's turn it on. I have already done that. It's actually at 0 volts. So I can go ahead and start increasing the voltage from the source meter. So 0.1 volt, you can see nothing's happening. The source meter is taking 5.8 microamp, nothing. Then we go to 0.2 volt, nothing's happening. Now it's taking 0.37 milliamp. We go to 0.3 volt, there we go, and it kicks in. There it is. So by providing it with only 0.3 volts, and it's taking something along the lines of maybe a few milliamps or so, it is providing a constant 3 volt from the LDO and a constant 5 volt from the output. This is of course under no load at all. So I can increase the voltage, 0.4 volt, 0.5 volt. Obviously nothing is going to happen because these are both supposed to stay constant. So I'm going to continue to go up. I'm at 1 volt now, 2 volts, and continue 3 volts, 5 volts, which is the maximum. There it is. So I'm sourcing 5 volts to it, no problems. I can go back down, all the way down to where we were before. 1 volt, 0.4 volts, there it is. 0.3 volts, like I was doing before, no problem. I go down to 0.2 and it loses regulation. So as soon as you can see that this voltage can never be greater than that voltage. So if I go back to 0.3 volts again, you can see it kicks back up to 5 volts and 3 volts. So you can see without any load, it's working really well. But the question is, how much load can it take? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to connect a potentiometer like this one. This is a 20 turn potentiometer from Helipod, which is actually quite a good quality one. It is 500 ohms, so I'm going to use that in order to have some controlled resistive load, constant resistor load, and I'm going to measure the current that the unit takes using the Agilent 34401A. So let's hook it up and see what happens. So here I've changed the setup just a little bit here. I have added the potentiometer directly on, in parallel with the output main output voltage, which I've set to 5 volts. I've also added a resistor. Right now the resistor is 1 kilo ohm directly across the 3 volt regulated output. So if the 3 volt regulated output actually achieves regulation, then I should be able to put 3 milliamp through this resistor. I also have another resistor. It's one of 500 ohm resistor, which I can replace this with, and that will take me 6 milliamp, which is the maximum current that it is rated for the LDOs. Now, as for the main output, which is set to 5 volts right now, the potentiometer is set to 500, so I should be able to get 10 milliamps, but I can change the potentiometer and lower it and have a constant resistance load and get, you know, as much current as I want from the output, so we can see the efficiency as well as to see if the, if it can actually provide us with the output voltage under various input voltages. So if I go ahead right now, if I were to turn everything on using the lowest voltage we tested from before, which was 0.3 volts, I should be able to get 3 milliamp in here at 3 volts, and I should be able to get 10 milliamp in there at 5 volts. So let's turn it on. Everything is set to zero. This guy, by the way, I forgot to mention, is in series with the potentiometer, so you can see the current that is being delivered to the potentiometer here. The current through this, I'm not measuring. It's a constant resistor, and the output should be 3 volts. So let's see what we get. I'm going to go ahead. This is set to 3.3 volts again. I'm going to turn it on, and let's see what happens. So first thing to note is that the LDO achieves regulation at 3 volts, even though the output voltage is only at 0.9 volts. So the output voltage has failed to reach the 3 volt as it is supposed to, but I am able to get my 3 volt here. And this is because the chip, and this is important, you should keep that in mind, is that the IC gives priority to the LDO output before the main output voltage. And it does that because it charges the auxiliary voltage, as I showed you on the block diagram, and it transfers the charge to the output only when the LDO has achieved regulation. So that's why I'm able to get 3 volts constant here and only 0.9 volts at the output. But let's see what else I'm, by the way, I'm getting 1.8 milliamps because that's just, you know, 1 volt approximately divided by 500. So that's what I'm getting here. But let's see, it's taking a lot of current. Under this condition, let's see what its efficiency is. It should be very poor. So I'm going to add the total power I'm getting into my load. I'm going to divide it by the total power I'm providing the circuit with. So let's try that. I'm getting 0.9 volts here. So 0.93 times the total current I'm getting, which is 1.8 milliamps. 1.8 exponent minus exponent, where's my minus? Minus 3. And I'm going to add the power consumption that I'm getting from here. That's 3 times 3 exponent minus 3. There it is. And I'm going to divide that by the total power I'm providing. And the total power I'm providing is 0.3 volts, and I'm putting 270 milliamp in there. That's quite a bit. And enter. There it is. 131 milli. So that's 13.1% efficiency, which is really, really bad. But that's because you're operating it with such a small input voltage. So let's change that. But let me show you one other thing first. If I were to remove this load, the LDO load, that means that the chip will now be able to transfer more of that power to the output voltage. So the output voltage should rise. I'm going to disconnect it, like so. You can see it goes all the way to 3.1. It still cannot achieve regulation because it has now a load and it's putting 6.2 milliamp in it, but it's not able to achieve regulation. I'm going to connect it back again and it goes back down. Now, if you notice that it didn't go back down to 0.9, it only went down to 1.9. And the reason is because the IC failed to actually start in its regular asynchronous regulation, but once I removed the load, it powered on, it entered its synchronous regulation. That's why it can now do more. If I were to turn it off and turn it back on, it now can only go up to 0.9 because it hasn't achieved synchronous boost conversion. Anyhow, that's just a minor detail. So let's go ahead and increase the voltage until we get something meaningful, until we actually get a regulation here. So you had 0.3 volts, let's increase that. Go here, 0.4 volts, there you go, almost there. 0.5 volts, you can kind of see that it is there. And if you listen carefully, I don't know if the microphone picks it up, but there's that screeching noise. That's the sound from the inductor being charged and discharged, which mechanically actually shakes the inductor, and you can hear that sound. That's from the boost converter. Okay, so let's increase the voltage a little bit more. 0.6 volts, let's go all the way to 1 volt. There it is. Enter. Oops, I turned it off by mistake. There it is. So at 1 volt, I am getting now 4.9, and I'm almost getting my 10 milliamps. So let's calculate the efficiency again. Remember, the efficiency was 13% before. So the efficiency now is 4.92 times 9.7 exponent minus 3. We add the power we're getting from here, 3 times 3 exponent minus 3. And we divide that by the total power that we are dissipating, which is 1 times 0.164. There it is. Now our efficiency is up to 34.5%, which is much better than before. But let's see how much power I can dissipate into my potentiometer before I lose regulation. Let's say we set our threshold. If this guy drops below 4.8, we say that it has failed regulation. So let's see. I'm going to reduce the potentiometer right here. I'm going to just turn the potentiometer, and let's get this guy current. We'll have our eye on that. There you go. 10 milliamp, not bad. It's still nicely at 4.9. Now it's 11 milliamp. No problem, still doing well. Let's go a bit faster. Still above 4.8, and there it is. Let's say 25 milliamp. So at 1 volt, I'm able to deliver 3 milliamp into my 3 volt supply, and 4.8 volts I can get from the output and deliver 25 milliamp into my potentiometer. So it's still doing pretty good. Let's increase the voltage to 1.5 volt, let's say a AA battery. And let's calculate our efficiency again. And let's actually make it more interesting. Let's go to 50 milliamp. There we go, there's your 50 milliamp. Okay, let's do this again. Quickly, calculate the efficiency. 3 times 3 exponent minus 3 from the 3 volt supply plus 4.84, let's say, times 50 exponent minus 3, that's the total power dissipated into the loads. We'll divide that by the total power delivered, which is 1.5 times 0.348. And efficiency is now 48%. So that's pretty good. It's getting better. But the best efficiency is actually delivered at higher input voltages. And the reason for that is because the higher your input voltage is, the less peak current needs to go through the inductor during the boost conversion, and the losses of the inductor, of course, are reduced when you, the total loss is reduced when you put less current in it, and also it adjusts the switching speed and so on to stay at its highest efficiency. Let's increase the voltage. I like to go to 2.5. There. Now let's see how the efficiency is. I'm going to reduce the potentiometer to get exactly 50 millivolts. There we go. All right, it's good enough. So now you can see I'm getting my perfectly 5 volt exactly as I'm supposed to. 50 milliamp. Let's do this quickly again. 3 times 3 exponent minus 3 plus 5 times 50 exponent minus 3. And we'll divide that by 2.5 times 0.1291. There it is. That's kind of what I was looking for. An efficiency of 80%. And that's kind of what you should expect if you have a reasonable input voltage for your applications. I can increase this voltage all the way to 5 volts and it will be no problem. That's another thing I really like about this IC. There it is. I'm going to 4 and 5 volts. There. There you go. 5 volts. So at 5 volt, I'm able to deliver 50 milliamp, no problem. It should be extremely efficient now because the inductor needs to do basically nothing, because all it's doing is barely switching around in order to be able to do that. But here's the other good thing is, let me turn this off and let me reduce the output voltage to 3.3 volts. Now, this, the input voltage now is supposed to exceed the output voltage. And you can see I'm getting perfectly 3.3 volts. Even though the input voltage is larger, I can change the input voltage by 1 volt at a time. 5 volts, 4 volts, 3 volts, now it's below this, 2 volt, 1 volt, below this again, I can go back up, 2 volts, 3 volts, 4 volts, above, 5 volts, no problem. So this actually demonstrates something really important. Let me go to 1 volt again. It means that if you have a solar panel connected to this thing, the output voltage of the solar panel can change greatly over the, depending on the sunlight condition. It can go above your regulation voltage, it can go below regulation boost voltage, and you will always get your constant voltage in here, which is a very important feature of this IC, which I really like. So I can, let's try and take a lot of current, and let's just see that it is indeed capable of giving us 10 milliamp at 100 milliamp at 5 volts. Could turn it on. I'm going to change the voltage, let's say, to 2.5 again. I'm going to increase the current to 100, as it is promised to do. And you can see that it does that without any problems. There it is. So it can give me 100 milliamp, which is 0.1 amp, obviously, at 5, that's 0.5 watt into my resistor. And at the same time, I'm getting 3 milliamps into my resistor. I can actually change that. Let's put that to 6 milliamp, as it is advertised to be the maximum. Turn this on again. There you go. I'm going to add this resistor to my 3 volt supply. There it is. There you go. No problem. You can see it's perfectly regulated at 3 volts. And under this condition, from a 2.5 volt input, let's one last time calculate our efficiency. 3 times now it's 6 milliamp. Plus 4.946 times 100, which is 0.1, and we'll divide that by a total power dissipated, 2.5 times 0.259. There it is. Again, approximately 80%. So very good, no problem. And I can reduce the input voltage and see when this goes below 4.8. 2.3 volts, 2.2 volts, 2.1 volt, 2 volts, 1.9, 8, see, no problem. It's doing a very good job. There we go. Approximately, let's say 1. Should be able to do it at 1.5 approximately. Yeah, anyhow, 1.57, let's say. There it is. 1.58 volts. So at 1.58 volts, I'm able to deliver 0.5 watt into a constant load, as well as 6 milliamp into my LDO. And the unit works perfectly, exactly as advertised. Efficiencies can be higher than 80%, somewhere up to 84%. I've measured under some voltage conditions, I can get up to 84%. So you can see the IC works. The voltage can go above and below the regulated voltage. I can change the voltages and regulate them into anything I want. Right now I'm at 4.8 volts. I can even regulate 1.8 volts for some applications, and in the other output I can regulate 1.5 volts if you have a low CMOS application. There it is, turn it back on, 1.5 volts, 1.8 volts, no problem, it works really well. So let's do something else with it. Now what I wanted to do is I wanted to try it out with actually a solar panel. I bought this guy, this is an SLMD121H08 solar panel. It's very small and it's very narrow for some kind of a mounting on, let's say, like a calculator, a big calculator, for example, you would use maybe just half of that. And this is a, I believe it's a maybe a 23% efficient, I can't quite remember, but it's open circuit voltage is 5 volts, which is just the maximum the IC can accept, and its short circuit current is 50 milliamps. So this is perfect for this application because its voltage will never go above to damage the IC, and it can go anywhere from 0 to 5 volts, and it's most efficient Yeah, at around, I believe I'm not mistaken, around 1.5 or 2 volts. So I can set the maximum power point control of the IC to something around that voltage to get to operate this at its maximum efficiency, which is again a very nice feature of the IC. And I'm going to shine a halogen light on this because I have no sunlight here in the room anymore. It's getting dark outside. So I will put some halogen lamp on top of this to give it energy, connect it to the IC, and generate some voltage. And to make it more interesting, I actually have two of these. So I can use the first one to charge something and connect the output of that into this guy, and then connect the output of this guy into my circuit, whatever I want to power. Let's say it could be maybe an LED for like a flashlight in emergency, or it could be some sensor or a microcontroller, it doesn't matter. So now, what do I use to store energy? Well, I can use lithium polymer batteries, of course, and I can set this to charge lithium polymer batteries. The very nice, again, another feature of this IC is that you never have to worry about shorting the output. I can short the output together, and I can short these two output together, and it will never damage the IC because it has short protection, and it will enter constant current mode. So it's all automatically taken care of inside the IC itself. But for charging, I thought I would use supercapacitors because supercapacitors will work on very, very low temperatures, unlike lithium polymer batteries. So you can charge a supercapacitor with it, and then because it works as vol to in voltages as low as 0.3, 0.25 volts, it can almost completely drain the supercapacitor. And that's the problem with these guys, that if you don't fully drain them, then there is some energy stored in here that you will never use. Remember that you don't want to completely drain your lithium polymer battery because you will damage it. You don't want to go below 3 volts. But for these guys, you want to go down to almost zero because you want to take all the power that you put into it out. This supercapacitor has only 2.5 volt voltage, maximum voltage on it, so the most I can charge it is up to 2.5, but it's a 10 farad capacitance. But I looked at this and I said, ah, this is not so good. It's too small. So I bought this guy. Let me hide the capacity so you can take a guess. There it is. This is a 2.5 volt one again. And you want to take the capacity? Ready? 3, 2, 1. 400 farads. This guy has 40 times more capacity than this guy, even though obviously it's not 40 times as large. And this is a newer technology than this older one. So this is probably one of the highest densities that I could find. And I bought this for about $23-$24 from DigiKey, and I think that's a pretty good deal. It also says what's the total amount of energy stored in it, 0.35 watt hour. That's a lot of energy in this capacitor, and it has obviously plus and minus terminal. The other two terminals on this super cap are just for mechanical stress relief, essentially, so that when you solder this to a board, you have 4 points of contact to hold it down as opposed to just the two. That's the only reason why those two are there. So what I'm going to do is I can use both of these. I can start with the little one and use the solar panel, connect the first board to the solar panel, charge the capacitor, go from the charge capacitor to the second one, and then connect it to something else. So let's set that up. So here's an example of a kind of system I had in mind. I am using a potentiometer here at the top directly in order to be able to adjust the output voltage of the first evaluation board to 2.5 volts so I can charge a super cap with it. The selection, the jumpers that are on the board themselves don't allow directly for 2.5, but since this is a essentially just a resistor divided in the feedback path, I can choose whatever I want. So I've already adjusted that one for 2.5 volts. So the whole system looks like the following. So I have my solar panel there, sitting under a bright light, and the cable from the solar panel just directly comes through and is connected to the first evaluation board, which is used, and it's using this essentially as a source for energy harvesting. The output of the first board is set to 2.5 volts. I'm taking that directly and I'm connecting it to my super capacitor, the 400 farad one. Now, one thing I want to note is that solar panel that I'm using is really, really small. For such a large capacitor, you want to use a larger solar panel because it's going to take forever to charge this. I've actually manually kind of almost charged it up, otherwise I would have had to wait, you know, very, very long time. But anyhow, the principle is the same. You can use the smaller super cap if you wanted to, and it will charge this much faster. So then I take the output of the super cap and I directly connect it to a second evaluation board, which I have set to 5 volts, and I'm taking the output 5 volts of that, and I'm connecting it to this little board here, which is just this USB interface board with potentiometers on it to adjust the voltages to control the charge rate, and then I'm connecting it to my iPhone. So right now my phone is charged, partially charged. Right now everything's turned off. So what is that? Say it's a 71% charged. So everything is connected. This board is in shutdown mode. This board is turned on and charging. So if I look at the voltage on the supercap, it's at 2.49, and you can see it's slowly going up now, 2.4911. If we wait long enough, there it is, it goes to 2. So it's actually being charged, but very, very slowly. So you need a bigger solar panel. But the principle of operation remains the same. So now I have this both linked up, and this is the output voltage of the second evaluation board, which is right now turned off, so that's why you're reading only 2.9 millivolts. So let me put this camera back on the tripod. There we go. There it is. So there is my phone right there. Everything, as you can see, hooked up. So what I can do is I can go ahead and turn the second evaluation board on, and we'll see what happens. Now, one thing I want to note again is that the iPhone minimum iPhone charging current is 500 milliamps at 5 volts. But this IC cannot give me 500 milliamp. We know that it can give you only about 110, 120 milliamp at most, and then the output voltage drops. But it's fine because it has built-in protection. I can connect it to the iPhone directly and it will charge it, just not very fast. So let's go ahead and put this guy in an on position with the jumper, and you can see the iPhone should start to charge up. There it is. There you go. So now the iPhone is being charged. You can see the charge symbol came on. And if you look at this voltage, the output voltage of the evaluation board is now sitting at 4.2 volts because it cannot give me 5 volts as it's supposed to. So it's giving me as much current as it can, and it's charging the iPhone. And the supercap voltage is going to be dropping. There it is. You can see it's dropping relatively rapidly. But at this rate, now here's the very nice thing. I can almost completely discharge this cap, because this board will work all the way down to 0.3 volts or maybe 0.5 volts in order to still give me about 4.2. I can still go down all the way down to almost complete discharge in this cap. So that's a very nice feature of this IC. At the same time, I'm still charging the iPhone, of course, and I can wait and see how much charge I can put into it before basically the IC stops. But this is great for an emergency situation if you have this nicely packaged into one PCB with a super cap, and a super cap can be sitting around charging up, and then you can use it when you need it, and it will work in very, very, very low temperatures, which is a huge benefit which batteries will not be able to do. So if I were to go ahead and disable the charge like so, if I can figure this out, there it is, I've just disabled it, so you can see the charge stopped, the voltage went down to zero, and now the voltage on the super cap is now going to again very, very slowly rise from the solar panel being charging it. So you can see it works really nicely. I like these ICs very much, and I give them a try. Pick them up, pick up an IC, put it on these are actually you can buy them in two different packages, so you can put it on your PCB and experiment with them. You can experiment with different size of inductors depending on the type of source that you have. But you can see I've put together a complete solution for an emergency cell phone charger using these two boards. Oh, and that's my phone ringing. I turned it off. So let's go on to the second evaluation board. And so here's the block diagram of the LTC3109 energy harvesting IC. I'm showing it just for the sake of completeness. The principle of operation is quite similar to the previous chip that we were looking at, except that this one uses two independent transformers at the input, and it does so because, as I mentioned, it's able to work even if the polarity of the input is reversed. And it can work as low as, you know, 30 millivolts, and the way you can do that is that these transformers have a 1 to 100 ratio, turn ratio. So if you could somehow induce a small current to be taken from the primary or the secondary, whichever one is the 1 to 100, if you induce a small current, you can actually create a voltage on the other side that's 100 times larger in theory. And so therefore, if you have 30 millivolts on one side, all you need to do is to take a bit of current, kickstart the other secondary coil of the transformer so that you can get up to 300 millivolts or even higher, 3 volts, and then you can quickly get the whole thing started. So really only the startup circuitry in this is critical. As soon as you start the whole thing, then you have enough voltage on the other side of the transformers, and you can then do your boost conversion continuously. And I suspect that the startup circuitry again uses deep sub-threshold CMOS technology, where you bias the transistors well below the threshold, and they have an exponential current characteristic, and you just take a bit of current from the transformer and you get it started. So as a result, this of course requires two transformers, and they're much larger than the other IC, but then you can start using them at very low voltages. It also has a whole bunch of other features similar to before. It has a built-in linear regulator. It tells you if the output power has reached the good level that you're looking for. It has a synchronous rectifiers on the inside, so that once the startup condition has been met, the whole synchronization becomes synchronous, which is very nice. The rectification becomes synchronous, and a whole bunch of other again features inside. It has internal references. It also has a store pin that you can put a capacitor on the outside of the IC. So if your load is not taking current, you don't want to waste any energy, you can actually use the VSTOR pin to store it up inside like a super cap, maybe a small super cap on the board, so that you don't waste any energy that might be coming in to your circuit from outside. And it also has two outputs. It has a main output and a secondary output, and it can program the output voltages using these two pins, and they have some preset values depending on these resistor divider that's already built into the chip. It also has a pulsed output mode, which can be very useful if you have, let's say, some kind of a sensor, and then you want to just pulse the sensor on and off whenever there is enough energy available. So then by using this, you wait, you charge up your capacitor, you get the voltage that you want, then you just pulse it, and then it takes some voltage from the output and turns your sensor on briefly. Your sensor does what it is, collects the data, and then transmits it and goes back to sleep. So it's pretty sophisticated and intended for this type of distributed sensors that are completely off-grid and just steal energy from wherever they can. So let's go ahead and take a look at the evaluation board, turn it on, and see what happens. And here's the LTC3109 evaluation board. You can see the IC here right in the middle, and it is supported by these two big 1-to-100 transformers. It has its own little storage capacitors. You can see these two pins here. You can add further storage to it. It has a charge and a discharge jumper, where you can discharge the capacitor if it's halfway charged. Here's your LDO output, here's your main output, and here's your pulsed output. And what they've done here is that they have placed a little LED right at the tip of this pen. There's a little LED in there which can blink, synchronized to the pulsed output, so you can see the pulsed output in action if you don't have a load connected to it. So we're going to use this LED to see that we have accomplished energy harvesting. And here's our two jumpers that can set the voltage, and here's a little table that tells you what voltages you can achieve by a different combination of these jumpers. And the output voltage can be 2.35, 3.3, 4.1, and 5 volts. Right now it's set to 5 volts. And I have set the secondary output to be pulsed. It can either be continuously on, off, or pulsed. So I'm left it on pulse mode. And here are the two inputs. They can be anywhere from 50 millivolt to 400 millivolt, 50 millivolt to 400 millivolt. It could be any polarity. So I've just arbitrarily connected it up. And I've connected it up again, once again, to the Keithley source meter. And at the top, I have the Keithley source meter directly connected to the board. And at the bottom, I am monitoring the output voltage on one of the outputs of the board. So one of the outputs is directly connected to this one, and the other output, as I mentioned, is connected to the LED, which will blink. So let's see what happens. Let me do this. If we can get everything in one shot. Here we go. I don't know if that LED is going to be visible. I have a lot of junk on my table right now, but let's see. Okay, let's try the sound. So I'm going to turn it on. Right now is at 0 volts, so it's not doing anything, and the output voltage is sitting at 0.7 volts. It's not completely discharged from the last time I experimented with it. So let's raise the voltage slowly. Let's try 10 millivolt. So at 10 millivolt, nothing really happens. 20 millivolt, it's taking 2.9 milliamps. And the output, no, it's not really doing anything. Let's go a little bit higher, 0.3 volts. And let's see now, there we go. So now it's starting to do something. And if you look, the output voltage that I'm applying to it is only 30 millivolts. It's taking 6.5 milliamps, and the output voltage is slowly rising. Now it's 1.4, 1.5. If you wait long enough, this will continue to go up, and you will actually see the LED will start to blink once it reaches approximately 5 volts. It's going to take some time at 30 millivolts, so let me just briefly increase it. 0.4. Let's go to 50 millivolts and allow it to charge much faster. You can see it's charging much, much faster. And it's going to reach almost five volts. And once it reaches about 4.5 volts, then the extra energy is getting transferred to the pulsed output. And let's take a look. Here we go. There it is. I think you should be able to see it on camera. You see, that is the effect of the energy harvesting from the power supply at right now at 50 millivolt, but I can reduce it back to 30 millivolt. There we go. So right now the output is at 30 millivolt, it's taking 5.3 milliamps, and the output is staying constant at about 4.56, and the LED still blinks, just not as fast. There it is, you see? Occasionally it blinks. So this chip really does work, and it really does convert 30 millivolts to 5 volts. If I were to disable the pulsed output completely and don't use the energy for on the LED, the output will rise and reach eventually 5 volts, and it will stay at 5 volts. So let's try and do actually something more interesting than just connecting it on like that. Let me connect this back to pulsed. Let's see what we can do with some kind of a thermoelectric charger. So here I have a Peltier cooler. A Peltier cooler is essentially a thermoelectric pump, and it's a solid state device. It composes of two different materials, a junction, typically two different metals that come together inside this ceramic container. And if I were to apply current to this, as I mentioned, it's like a heat pump, and it will transfer heat from one side of this plate to the other side of this plate. So what you can do is, well, you can heat stuff with it, but that's not what people usually use it for. They usually use it to cool things. So if I were to place a heat sink on the hot part and keep the hot part at room temperature by dissipating the energy back into the environment, I can get the other side to go well below the room temperature. In fact, it can reach below freezing, and some portable refrigerators or some small refrigerators that you can use in your office, for example, use these Peltier coolers. So they're very, very popular. They're not very efficient, but they're quite popular because they have no moving parts, so they don't really fail, and they're solid state and they're very small. So if I were to apply current to this, I can create a temperature differential on either side of these Peltier cooler. So if I push current into it, one side gets hot, the other side gets cold, and if I pull current from it, the reverse will happen. But I can also use, again, the reverse of the whole idea of putting current into it, and I can put a temperature difference across it. And if I do that, then it will do the opposite, and it will give me current instead. So let's see that principle in action. I'm going to place it here on the table, so I'm not even using a heatsink or anything. And you can see right now, as it is sitting on a table, if I let it just sit for a moment, right now I've been handling it, so it's actually generating some voltage on one side because there is a temperature difference between my table and the ambient. But I'm going to place my hand on one side of it, and you can take a look at the voltage. It can reach all the way to minus 100 millivolt just from the heat of my hand. Now if I were to flip it upside down, and I now cool the other side with the table, and I put my hand on the other side, you can see that it goes the other way. Now it's reaching about 100 millivolt positive. It was 100 millivolt negative. So this is a perfect ideal energy harvesting device for the LTC3109, because the LTC3109 can handle either positive or negative input. So if I stick this on some surface, which is sometimes hotter than ambient and sometimes cooler than ambient, I can continuously harvest energy from the temperature difference between that surface and the ambient environment. So it's perfect. So, and you can see that I could easily get 100 millivolt, and let's just see how much current I can get just from the temperature difference between my hand and the table. So I'm gonna put it in the current mode. And of course it's going to complain. So we're going to go right here. So let's measure some current. Let's see how much current I can get from it. Again, I'm just going to place my hand on top of it. And you can see I can get about 20 milliamp just from the temperature difference between my hand and the table. And you saw that the IC can easily work with currents as low as 5 milliamp and as voltages as small as 30 millivolts. So you should have no problem getting energy harvested from this Peltier cooler. So let's hook it up to the circuit and see what happens. Here we go. I just connected the Peltier cooler directly to the circuit. Nothing else. There's nothing else in here except the Peltier cooler and the evaluation board. And right now the output is sitting at 3.7 volts. So let me turn the light off so we can see if the LED blinks. I'm going to tilt it a little bit this way. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to put my hand, the palm of my hand, on top of the Peltier cooler right here in camera. And here's the voltage that it's generating. So here we go. You can see it's rapidly rising. 4.34, and look at that. I don't know if you can see or not, but you can see the LED right here. It's blinking quite rapidly and it's sitting at 4.5 volts. So I can easily harvest enough energy just from the temperature from my hand to create the blinking LED. So now I removed it. So of course it stops blinking and the voltage is going to slowly go down. But I can flip the Peltier cooler like so. And I put my hand again. So now the temperature difference is opposite of what it used to be. And if you wait again, you can see, once again, I can get just enough energy to blink this LED, no problem. So, and if I can blink an LED like that so quickly, I can easily harvest enough energy to turn on the sensor and transmit a wireless message. So I have one other cool experiment to do and then we'll be done. So as my last experiment, what I want to do is I want to put these ice cubes into my cell phone. Well, technically I want to use the energy that was used to freeze these ice cubes and use that energy back into putting it back into my phone to charge it. If you think about it, the refrigerator or the freezer that was used to create these uses electricity in order to extract heat directly from water in order to create ice. And furthermore, water has quite a high heat capacity. So there's a lot of energy essentially stored in these ice cubes in a way. And so what I've done is I've put two of them in the speaker and I've added some salt to it in order to reduce the melting temperature of ice even further to create a bigger temperature difference between the ice and the ambient. And how am I going to extract that? Well, I've put my Peltier cooler on top of a big copper heat sink at the bottom. So the heat sink is sitting at room temperature and I've put on top of the Peltier cooler a piece of a thermal putty in order to create a good junction between the bottom of the beaker and one of the surfaces of the Peltier cooler. This is a normal practice, of course, that's what those thermal putties are used for. So I'm monitoring the voltage across the thermal putty on my Fluke 289, so it's sitting at 1.8 millivolt because the temperature at the top and the bottom is the same. Then what I've done is I've connected the Peltier cooler directly at the input of the LTC3109 energy harvesting IC. The output of that is set to 5 volts and I've connected that to two supercapacitors that are in series, 2.5 volt each, so that I have 5 volts at 5 farad of capacity, and I'm monitoring the voltage of the supercapacitor sitting at 230 millivolt, essentially pretty much almost discharged. And then I'm taking the output of the supercap again, like the last experiment, I'm using the LTC3105 evaluation board, connected, set to 5 volts, connected to my USB, little USB charging thing, and onto my phone. So right now my phone is not being charged, it's just sitting there because this isn't turned off, and anyhow the capacitors are discharged anyway. So let's go ahead and start this little charging process. So here's my, turn this back on. Let me steer this guy a little bit. There we go. My ice is already partially melted. I'm going to have to get some more ice later. So let's go ahead and place this directly on top of our Peltier cooler. So I'm going to try and center it. Here we go. So now have your eye on this. Press it down. There we go, nice and close. Here you go. So I'm able to create about minus 90 millivolts. The polarity doesn't matter, of course, because I can connect it in any orientation that I want. Actually, it's still dropping. So I have about maybe minus 100 millivolts that I can create using these ice cubes. And as they melt continually, the bottom heat sink will dissipate the temperature difference back into the atmosphere, so the heat will come in and warm the bottom plate and the top plate will remain cold. And this is a kind of temperature and the potential difference that I can get. If you remember, I could operate that IC with 30 millivolts, so with 100 millivolts is no problem. And if you look here, let me lower this guy a little bit, there we go. I am slowly but surely charging my capacitors very, very slowly. This last digit is at 10 microvolts. So you can see it's going to do it, it's just going to take some time. So I'm going to let this run for a while and just continue to charge the cap, and I'm going to drop in more ice and remove the water as necessary. So let's wait a little bit. Well, after a bunch of ice cubes, my patience has run out. I've charged the caps to 1.5 volts. Now right now the ice is melted, and then my temperature difference has dropped to about 30 millivolts. So I'm actually slowly beginning to going backwards. I'm actually discharging the caps now. So here it is that this cap was charged to 1.5 volts at 5 farads, just using a whole bunch of different ice cubes. And after an excruciating long time, I have now charged the cap to a point where I can charge the phone. Here we go, I'm going to remove the jumper, and let's see how long I can charge this phone. I'm going to read the voltage to you, actually. Anyhow, as I remove this, you're going to see that it's going to start charging. So here we go. There it is. It's charging, and the whole energy came from just ice cubes from my freezer. And the voltage is dropping rapidly, 0.7, 0.6, 0.5, and I think that's about it. I believe it's still charging. It is still charging. It's going to stop any moment now. I could only charge it for, I think, less than 30 seconds, if I'm not mistaken. Well, it's still going. It's still going, and the voltage has reached now 0.36 volts, 3.35 volts. And there, I think this was it. Amazing. It's still going. There it is. There it is. That was it. So you can see I managed to charge my phone for quite a bit of time using nothing but ice cubes and this crazy setup. Well, I hope you enjoyed these different experiments using these energy harvesting ICs. I strongly recommend that you go on the Linear Technology website, take a look at the data sheet. Even if you're not interested to use them, it's good to learn about them and see how they work. And I want to extend my gratitude to Linear Technology for sending me these evaluation boards and making this type of experiments possible for you guys. So feel free to drop them a line, let them know where you saw this video and that you saw these evaluation boards if you like them, so that they may say something else in the future and we can do other cool experiments. Well, Happy New Year, and until next time.